أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وأفضل الصلاة والتسليم على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد وعلى آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا واللعنة الدائمة الأبدية على أعدائهم أجمعين من الآن إلى قيام يوم الدين. قال الله تعالى في كتابه الكريم وقوله الحق. الله سبحانه وتعالى states in the Holy Quran and what he states is the truth. In the chapter of Al-Anbiya, chapter 21, verse 73, Allah says, وَجَعَلْنَاهُمْ أَئِمَّةً يَهْدُونَ بِأَمْرِنَا وَأَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْهِمْ فِعْلَ الْخَيْرَاتِ وَإِقَامِ الصَّلَاةِ وَإِتَاءِ الزَّكَاةِ وَكَانُوا لَنَا عَابِدِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states in this verse, he says, and we placed them on this earth as imams, as leaders, to guide by our command. And we revealed unto them how to do good deeds, how to pray, how to give charity. And to us, they were worshippers. صدق الله العلي العظيم. آمنا بالله. Brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. And welcome to another episode. As we go through the theology of Islam, the foundational information that we need in order to build a strong system of faith. Now, last episode, we left off in speaking about prophethood and proving it. And then we asked the question of, you know, is the Holy Quran enough for us after the Prophet passes away? Because there are certain groups that say, Hasbuna Kitabullah. So we'll deal with that on an intellectual level. We'll try to rationalize that claim and see what we come up with. And then we'll take a look at the Holy Quran and see what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states, since of course we did prove that the Quran is legitimately the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So to start off, intellectually speaking, now we know that if let's say for example, I'm a father of a household and I want to leave the house. Now, and I have kids. Now, would I leave my kids at home without someone to take care of them if I have to go on a business trip or a meeting? Of course not. Now who would I leave? Probably leave my wife to take care of them. So she would be my vice. She would take care of the kids when I'm gone. Also, if I own a company, let's say I'm a CEO of a company, right? And I travel, I'm going to have my vice president take care of affairs when I'm gone. If I'm the president of a country, right? And I leave on a trip, then who's going to take care of the affairs of the country? The vice president. If I am the principal of a school, and I leave the school, or I'm sick, who's going to take care of the school when I'm sick? The vice principal. So there is a logical necessity for there to be someone to take care of that role when the leader has left. And generally, that person, the next person in line, 9 times out of 10, if not 10 times out of 10, has to be someone that leader chose based on what? Their qualifications. They have to be the next person most qualified after that leader, right? It's just a logical necessity. We do it every day. Therefore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by priority, who gave us the ability to rationalize and deduce that this is what is needed, then he, by priority, would know that this is what we would need also if his representative was to pass away. And of course, this would be part of the greater plan that he planned, because we said he is the ultimate organizer, correct? We proved that already. So based on that then, based on our intellectual reasoning, we come to the conclusion that there is a necessity for a leader, and that leader has to be chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is why, now if we move on to the Holy Quran, that is why that leader must be mentioned in the Holy Quran, right? So, and where they would come from. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we mentioned past episode, we're going to review that verse again, in the chapter of Al-Imran, chapter 3, verses 33 and 34, where Allah says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ اصْطَفَى آدَمَ وَنُوحًا وَآلَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَآلَ عِمْرَانَ عَلَى الْعَالَمِينَ ذُرِّيَّةً بَعْضُهَا مِنْ بَعْضٍ. Meaning that surely Allah chose and purified. We said Adam alayhi salam, Nuh alayhi salam, the progeny of Abraham and the progeny of Al-Imran, ذُرِّيَّةً بَعْضُهَا مِنْ بَعْضٍ, meaning that that those who will be leaders on this earth will be from their progeny. So if you're not from their progeny, then you won't be a leader that is rightfully chosen by Allah. Correct? Now, based on that then, we're going to say the next thing is, since the Quran does definitely say that it has to be someone that Allah chose and it has to be someone that Allah purified, right? Then we know also that there has to be a continuation, because Allah mentions dhurriyatan, meaning that a progeny, meaning that there will be from their progeny leaders on this earth. But then, is there a necessity for that leadership or successorship to continue and every single time? Yes. Allah mentions this in the chapter of Al-Baqarah, chapter 2, verse 30, where He speaks to the angels, as we mentioned last episode, where He says, وَإِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً قَالُوا أَتَجْعَلُ فِيهَا مَنْ يُفْسِدُ فِيهَا وَيَسْفِكُ الدِّمَاءَ وَنَحْنُ نُسَبِّحُ بِحَمْدِكَ وَنُقَدِّسُ لَكَ قَالَ إِنِّي أَعْلَمُ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Now the first part of the verse is what interests us, because Allah here has a conversation with the angels. He says to them, I am placing on this earth a caliph, meaning a representative of mine on this earth. They go on to ask Him, will you place someone on this earth who is corrupt and will cause bloodshed? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I know what you do not know. Now, so we've established here that Allah is ja'ilun. We said that the morphological form of ja'il is fa'il, which means is always doing. The question is now, okay, well, if He was chosen and purified by Allah, right? And we know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala placed Him on this earth and He will continue to place a leader. That means that after the Prophet dies, there has to be a leader that Allah places on this earth. Now, what's interesting to clarify this point even more is that Allah has a conversation with Prophet Abraham in the Holy Quran, in chapter 2, the chapter of Al-Baqarah, verse 124. Allah has a conversation with Prophet Abraham. What does He say? He says, وَإِذْ ابْتَلَى إِبْرَاهِيمَ رَبُّهُ بِكَلِمَاتٍ فَأَتَمَّهُنْ قَالَ إِنِّي جَاعِلُكَ لِلنَّاسِ إِمَامًا قَالَ وَمِنْ ذُرِّيَّتِي قَالَ لَا يَنَالُ عَهْدِ الظَّالِمِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has tries Prophet Abraham alayhi salam with a few words. They have a complete conversation, and He says to them, I have elevated, He says to Ibrahim alayhi salam, says, I have elevated you to the level of an imam, meaning that the level of imamah, then you can be a prophet but you don't have to be an imam. Allah says, I elevated you to the level of an imam. So then Prophet Abraham says, well, what about my progeny, right? وَمِنْ ذُرِّيَّتِي. ذُرِّيَّة is the same word that's used in that chapter of Ali Imran, verse 34. ذُرِّيَّةً بَعْضُهَا مِنْ بَعْضٍ, right? So Allah says, well, what about my Abraham says, what about my progeny? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, just keep one thing in mind. This is a covenant. لَا يَنَالُ عَهْدِ الظَّالِمِينَ. And this covenant cannot be given to those who oppress. So the next question comes is, what is then the criteria? We understand that just as the criteria for the Quran was for it to be a consistent message, flawless message, because Allah is flawless, Allah is all perfect, and that the messenger himself has to be flawless because the stakes are too high, because he represents Allah and he must represent his perfection, then so too must the successor after him, whomever they may be, they must be chosen by Allah, number one. They must have that same characteristic of being flawless, otherwise no one would take them seriously or listen to them. And since it is Allah that placed them on this earth, then Allah determines and tells us there's no way that they could have oppressed. He gives us what? Several criteria. Now this important criterion is what I want to focus on for the next couple of minutes. Now, this is a covenant, and it is a covenant that is not given to those who oppress. Therefore, if someone bowed down to an idol at any point of their lives, even if they became Muslim, at any point, would they be considered as someone who oppressed themselves? The answer, of course, is yes. Now I ask you, if you have a choice between two leaders, one who never bowed down to an idol and one who did bow down to an idol, which would you choose? Of course, the one who never bowed down to an idol. Now, this is why we find that Imam Ali, or Ali ibn Abi Talib, the cousin of the Prophet, who was raised by the Prophet, who was the one that was there during the revelation, who was the first to write down the revelation himself, that it would be the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam who would announce his successorship. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would announce his successorship. And this is mentioned in the Holy Quran. In the chapter of Ma'idah, chapter 5, verse 55, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states, he says, إِنَّمَا وَلِيُّكُمُ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا الَّذِينَ يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ وَيُؤْتُونَ الزَّكَاةَ وَهُمْ رَاكِعُونَ. Now in this blessed verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, he uses إِنَّمَا. إِنَّ means surely. Ma is a tool of negation. If I put them together, it becomes a tool of confinement, adat hasr, in Arabic grammar, which means that Allah is confining what he's going to say, the subject of the sentence, to whatever is after the subject. So what is the subject of the sentence? Wilaya. He says, innama waliyukum, meaning mastership over you. What's mastership? What's waliyukum? Wali is the one who is more worthy of yourselves than you. So in the hadith of Thaqalain, as it is mentioned in both schools of thought, now of course in the other school of thought, we find that in the book of Sahih Muslim, specifically in the hadiths 6370 to 6374, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is addressing Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam, and what is he saying? He's saying to him, أنت مني بمنزلة هارون من موسى إلا أنه لا نبي من بعدي. So we find in the hadith, what is he saying? He says, you are of me as, or to me as Aaron was to Moses, except there is no prophet after me, meaning that you are my successor, except you're not a prophet. Now what we also find is that in this verse of Ma'idah that we just mentioned, Allah says your mastership again is what? Is this mastership that you have to follow is specifically confined to Allah, His Messenger, and those who believe. Who are those who believe? Everyone who believes? No, not everyone who believes. Allah uses another tool of confinement. He says, الَّذِينَ. So he says, الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. And then he says, الَّذِينَ يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ. Specifically those who pray. Everybody who prays? No. الَّذِينَ يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ وَيُؤْتُونَ الزَّكَاةَ وَهُمْ رَاكِعُونَ. Those are the ones specifically of the mu'mineen who give alms while they're in a state of ruku' within their prayer. And by consensus, both schools of thought agree that this verse was revealed about Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam when a beggar comes into the Prophet's mosque and asks for help. And it is only Ali ibn Abi Talib that gives him the ring that's on his hand while he's bowing in his state of salah. So the next thing is then, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then clearly mentions this. Now the hadith of manzila we mentioned in Sahih Muslim specifically refers to the idea of what? Of the fact that both schools of thought agree that the successor after Prophet Muhammad is Ali ibn Abi Talib. How do we know this? Because the hadith specifically says that you are of me as, or to me as Aaron was to Moses. And we know that the successor of Moses was Aaron. Therefore, the successor of Prophet Muhammad would have to be who? No one other than Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam. Now, this is important to recognize. Why? Because a lot of people say that the successorship of Ali ibn Abi Talib or the Imams after is not mentioned in the Holy Quran. However, we just proved that it is mentioned in the Holy Quran. Also, in the Sahih of Muslim, it mentions that he is to the Prophet as Aaron was to Moses. But let's take it one step further. In also Sahih Muslim, in the Hadith 6378, there's the Hadith of Thaqalain, which specifically says, the Prophet says, إِنِّي تَارِكٌ فِيكُمْ الثقلين. I'm leaving with you the two weighty things. What are they? Kitab Allah, فِيهِ هُدًى لِلنَّاسِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet says that it is a guidance to people, and that it is a light in the darkness. And then what does he say? He says, وَأَهْلَ بَيْتِي. He says, I'm leaving with you the two weighty things, the book of Allah and أَهْلَ بَيْتِي. He says, وَذَكِّرْكُمُ اللَّهِ فِي أَهْلِ بَيْتِي. وَذَكِّرْكُمُ اللَّهِ فِي أَهْلِ بَيْتِي. وَذَكِّرْكُمُ اللَّهِ فِي أَهْلِ بَيْتِي. Three times he says, And I remind you that you should hold steadfastly to my Ahlul Bayt, to my holy household. In the next episode, inshallah, we'll go through the proofs that prove who of Ahlul Bayt, who are Ahlul Bayt specifically, who of Ahlul Bayt should be followed. But until then, inshallah, I leave you with this short dua, which is Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, that we've reached to this point, inshallah. I ask that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows us to gain the knowledge that He wants for us so that we can stay on the right path. هذا والحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيد المرسلين حبيب إله العالمين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد وعلى آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين.